right now, there's a, as we happen to be making this course, there's a presidential transition underway. And I'm touched and impressed by the fact that both candidates have mentioned how important is this peaceful transition of power. Well, why don't they keep up that fabric of congeniality when it apparently is not real? Well, I think that's something deep, and I even think that's something unique. I think that happened in the United States of America for the first time in 1800. Unlike a king asserting he's the sovereign, now there's a popular vote, and in 1861, Abraham Lincoln says that that's the first time that ballots ever replaced bullets as the way to change a government. The revolution is the war, right? The war part. That's urgent, and it's often ridiculous. The soldiers are not paid. They don't know how to be soldiers. They run away. The George Washington, the senior commander, had never really been responsible to move a large body of troops from one place to another. Put them in action in a battle. He didn't even know how to get them there. And so they just got creamed all the time, right? And then, wonder of wonders, they up and won. They got better and better. So now they learn how to fight and they win the war. And what Washington really did was use the terrain of the nation, right? It's just a whacking big old country. If you don't believe that, ride a motorcycle across it. It's a wonderful experience and hard. And so they won the war. And it's the greatest thing that ever happened. And they won the war with all this language that we're reading. And then it becomes ridiculous. And can you tell why? Why was it ridiculous? I'm thinking of our reading Madison's Vices of the Political System. What is that?
It's a discussion of the states and how they were kind of trying to become their own sovereign powers and excluding each other and dissolving their own bonds between each other for no real reason, rejecting a federal power over all of them.
Correct. And what else were they doing?
Also, the inability to raise revenue. The states are failing to support the federal government that way.
And that means what happens? We're not paying our bills.
Yeah.
Right? And that means nobody will loan us any money. All around our borders and across our borders, foreign powers, these same people that we have accused of despotism and beat in a war, are taking territory. And then another thing is, they're debasing their currencies, he says, doesn't he? You need stable money. You need credit to be gettable, and you need the loans to be paid back. And the country, the economy, can grow. There's a kind of wounded tone to Madison's writing in Vices of the Political System, because think of this great thing they did. And now all of those aristocrats in Europe are saying, see, I told you they couldn't do it. These people trying to set up their own government, that's stupid. The king is right, they're gonna need us back. It's foolish. Come to find out, the moment of the calling of the Constitutional Convention is also an urgent moment. And it looks like it's all going to be lost. That it's gonna collapse into a lot of different little countries which will have borders with each other, which will look like Europe, right? Not big and united and secure and protected by the mountains and the oceans, but lots of little balkanized states. The whole thing could be lost. And so it's a big moment. And that's why they called the Constitutional Convention. And that means that the seed that we identify as having been planted in the Declaration of Independence, it had to grow into this other thing. And we've described how it grows logically, let us say, it would need to grow this way for things to work. You can see in principle why that might be true, but principle and practice are very different things. It's going to have to actually happen. Which states were the hardest to get ratification in?
Rhode Island.
That was that's right, the hardest of all. Those are stubborn folk, aren't they? And I think that's good. And then who else? Think of big states.
New York, Virginia.
Yeah, hard deal. New York and Massachusetts have very important big harbors. Lots of trade, in and out, across the sea, up and down the coast, right? They might like to levy some tariffs on their own. They have big reasons not to do it. You gotta remember, the Declaration of Independence was passed and signed, and the Constitution was debated and drafted and passed in the same room, in the same town, in the same building, right? It's amazing, you know? And both of them are amazing events. Incredible how it happened. And of course, what we like to talk about is how these big states and these little states had very different interests. The two probably chief leaders of the Constitutional Convention were probably Madison and Hamilton from which states?
New York.
And Virginia, right? They're going to have to write a constitution that achieves this thing, these things that they achieve, which is the separation of sovereignty from the operation of the government, which is the division of labor in the government among levels, which is the separation of powers between branches at each level. And they don't have that. And they're going to have to get it. And of course, they're going to have to get it when there are existing powers that have a stake in the current arrangements. I like to say that the American Revolution began in 1763, when the British began to mess with us, having won the 7 years of French and Indian War. It ended in 1800. What happened in 1800?
What was that? It was the abolition of the Federalist Party and the election of Thomas Jefferson.
Yeah, it was the destruction, not exactly the abolition, of the Federalist Party and the election of Thomas Jefferson and his new party, President of the United States. What's remarkable about that?
There's a new party in power. The voice of the people has spoken.
Okay. Garrison.
It's a peaceful transition of power from one kind of party to another.
According to a vote of the governed, in 1861, Lincoln says that the lesson of the founding of America, that election, is that ballots have replaced bullets as the way we choose our government. And that means these guys who turned on each other, right? Who worked every kind of political skullduggery against each other, except not that kind. There was a vote, and Jefferson was put in. The day came, and the Federalists moved out, and Jefferson's party, they moved in, and that's because the people said so. And the claim of them, and of Abraham Lincoln later, is that never happened before. And they say that it's the whole thing, right? The seeds, or to use the opposite metaphor, the final causes of the Union, the thing they loved and toward which they moved and to which they pledged their lives. That thing planted in the Declaration of Independence gave rise then to a structure for them all to cooperate in producing government. Government operating by consent. But remember, government is a piece of work. It's something that has to be done. Laws have to be made and enforced. Borders have to be protected. Trade has to be secured, right? That's a work. It has to go on all the time. And now there's a way for it to go on always with the consent of the governed and under their ultimate control. And the claim is, that's the first time. Never before. We did that. Our fathers and our mothers did that.